heard us mention before that a deep net at Google recently outperformed a human at an image recognition task, and you may have wondered how the performance was actually measured. The metric used for the comparison was known as error, and in this video, we'll take a look at the measurement of deep net performance. Error is a straightforward measurement that captures the proportion of data points classified incorrectly, typically from the test data set. The calculation is simply the number of incorrect classifications made by the net divided by the total number of classifications. Unfortunately, error has a significant drawback as a performance measurement, especially when the data points are skewed towards one class over another. Let's assume we are tasked with developing a medical model to diagnose a brain tumor that only occurs in about 1% of patients. With the objective of low error, we could design a model that always gives a negative diagnosis for every single patient. While the model would be useless in a practical setting, the error would be a seemingly low 1%. The problem arises when we measure error globally across the set of all classes, rather than taking a granular view of the model's performance at the class level. Let's illustrate this by looking at a two-class classification problem, where a data point is either considered positive or negative. If the model makes a positive classification, there are two possibilities. The model could be correct, in which case we have a true positive, or the model could be incorrect and the point is actually a negative, in which case we have a false positive. True negatives and false negatives are defined similarly when the model makes a negative prediction. If the number of occurrences of these four values are placed in a 2x2 grid, we form a valuable tool known as a confusion matrix. Each square in the matrix is a placeholder for a value, so the values are not related to any particular square's visual size. You could have values like this, or like this. Using this matrix, we can devise new measurements that overcome the issues of the error metric. We can do this by asking two related questions about the model's performance. We first look at the positives in the data set and ask, what percentage of these positives was the model able to correctly identify? This metric is known as recall, expressed as the number of true positives divided by the total number of positives in the data set. We can also look at the number of times the model predicted positive and ask what percentage of these predictions were actually positive. This metric is known as precision, expressed as the number of true positives divided by the number of data points classified as positive. These two questions sound similar, but spoken another way, we want to know how many of the positive data points was the model able to recall, and how precise were the actual predictions. Also keep in mind that precision and recall are defined for the negative data points as well. So going back to our brain tumor diagnosis example, the model had a recall of 0 for the positive class, simply because it failed to identify any of the patients from the data set with a positive diagnosis. As an additional example, let's consider a model that examines a pool of applicants for a top 5 U.S. business school, and determines which students to accept. We will say that accepting a student is a positive classification, and rejecting the student is a negative classification. Since business schools have very strict entry requirements, only the very best applicants will ultimately be accepted. So given the extremely low number of false positives, the model will have a high precision value. But there will be a large number of qualified students that had potential to perform well, but just barely miss out on the opportunity for one reason or another. This will be the model's false negatives, so the model will have a low recall value. A model for a U.S. state university undergraduate admissions would be designed a bit differently, since the goal is to admit a much larger number of students. A few underqualified students will likely be accepted, so the false positive count will be high. But unlike the previous model, very few qualified students will be overlooked, so the number of false negatives will be low. This model will have low precision and high recall. We can use hybrid measures in order to achieve a balance between precision and recall. One of these measures, the F1 score, is calculated as the harmonic mean of precision and recall, which outperforms the standard arithmetic mean in the presence of outliers. The harmonic mean is also an improvement when the features have values between 0 and 1, something which comes in handy during the process of feature scaling. We can also examine precision and recall graphically by plotting these values and examining the area under the curve. The model that maximizes this area will typically be the best performing. We can extend these concepts to classification problems with more than two classes. Here's what the confusion matrix might look like. The definitions for precision and recall remain the same as in the case of two-class classification. The difference is that now a data point can be misclassified in multiple ways, so false positives and false negatives must be summed over all the possible misclassification pairs. So for multi-class classification, precision is the ratio of the number of true positives over all points classified as positive, and recall is the ratio of the number of true positives over the total number of positives. All of these metrics are important tools for understanding the performance of our model. If you'd like to learn more about some of the hybrid measures built on precision and recall, please follow this link to Wikipedia. Next up, we'll take a look at how to train and run deep nets in a reasonable time.